In this video, we construct the subobject classifier for each of the 6 example categories of presheaves. If C is a small category with category of presheaves C hat, recall that 1. The subobject classifier omega is a presheaf taking an object C prime to the set of subobjects of the representable of C prime, and a morphism F to the pullback along underline F. So if R is a subobject of underline C, F upper star R is a subobject of underline C prime obtained by the following pullback. As an action diagram, we have the F restriction of a C figure R producing a C prime figure F upper star R. 2. Each set sub X is a priori a thin category, and so has a natural order structure, where R is less than or equal to R prime if and only if there exists a morphism making the following commute. We will not need this structure yet, however, we will return to it in a later video, and so we'll give the natural orders for each set of figures in omega. We will use the following notation in this video. For an object C and a presheaf X, we say little x is a C element of X, denoted as follows, to mean little x is a C figure of X. We want to stress the following point. Each figure in the subobject classifier omega determines a condition on figures of each container X, which classifies cohesive membership for figures in subobjects of X, and not just a condition of either being a figure in R or not a figure in R. In the case of the category of sets, however, there is no cohesivity between its figures. There is just one representable, and it coincides with the terminal set with just one element. The subobjects of a singleton set are the empty set and the singleton set itself. We write an upside down capital T for the empty subobject and call it the false figure, and capital T for the identity subobject and call it the true figure. The order is given by the linear order on two elements, where false is less than true. So the subobject classifier is given by the following container. The conditions on a subset R of X, classified by figures in omega, has only one level of conditions given by the only object in the category boldface 1. In this case, for figure little x in X, either X is in R or it is not. For example, if X is a set containing elements A, B, C, and D, and R is a subset containing A and C, then the characteristic map chi sub R takes A and C to true and B and D to false. Similarly, in the category set squared, which is the category of presheaves on the discrete category containing two elements, 0 and 1, there are two representables, underline 0 and underline 1, which have a single element in their respective compartments. The set of subobjects of underline 0 is the empty object and the identity, which we label as false sub 0 and T sub 0, similar for the subobjects of underline 1. In each case, there is a natural order on false less than or equal to true. Therefore, the subobject classifier is the following container with a true and false element in each compartment. Then the condition on a subobject R of X classified by figures in omega comes in two levels. For zero figures, if little x is a zero element of X, then either X is a zero element of R or it's not. Similarly for one figures, either a little x is a one element of R or it's not. For example, if X is the set squared container with A, B, C in the zero compartment and D, E in the one compartment, and R is the subobject with A, C in the zero compartment and E in the one compartment, then the characteristic morphism chi sub R takes the zero elements A, B, C to true, false, true, and one elements D, E to false, true. So in these first two examples, we haven't yet seen cohesive membership giving rise to conditions other than whether a figure is in a subobject or it is not. However, in the category of evolving sets, things get a little more interesting. Recall that the category of evolving sets is a category of presheaves on the small category generated by one object and one non-identity morphism sigma. The representable on the single object has the natural numbers as figures with a process which produces a subsequent number. The morphism underlying sigma between representables takes n to n plus 1. The subobjects of the representable are the empty subobject, and for each natural number n, there is a subobject, upper arrow n, which contains the tail of the representable starting at element n. When n is equal to 0, we have the identity subobject on the representable. The order between subobjects is opposite of the linear order on the natural numbers, with the bottom element false. Therefore, omega has a copy of the natural numbers and an element false. To determine the sigma action on omega, observe that pulling back upper arrow n along underlying sigma gives us upper arrow n minus 1. Therefore, the process goes backwards and counts down to 0. The pullback of the identity is always the identity. Thus, 0 is fixed under sigma. Also, the pullback of the empty container along any morphism is also the empty container, so there is a fixed point also at false as well. The conditions on a subcontainer R of X, classified by figures in omega, has one level, where for little x in X, either X is in R, or X is not in R, but there exists a minimal natural number n, such that sigma to the n boundary of X is in R, or X is not in R, and for each natural number n, the sigma n boundary of X is also not in R. For example, let X be the container with figures A through J, and the following sigma process, and R the subcontainer containing just E and F. Then for A, B, and C, they are forever apart from R by the sigma action, and so map under the characteristic morphism to false. D is one sigma step away from R, and thus is mapped to upper arrow 1. E and F are in R, and so are taken to true. G is one sigma step away, and is thus mapped to upper arrow 1. H, however, is 3 sigma steps away from being in R, and so is taken to upper arrow 3, I is then taken to upper arrow 2, and J to upper arrow 1. In the category of bouquets, which is a category of presheaves on the category with two objects V and L, and one non-identity morphism, little l. By Oneida, there is the following morphism of containers, where underline V is a container with one vertex and no petals, and underline L has one vertex and one petal. Underline little l is the obvious morphism which takes vertex to vertex. The subobjects of underline V are the empty subobject and the identity, while the subobjects of underline L are the empty subobject, the object P sub V, with one vertex and no petals, and the identity subobject. Therefore, omega has two vertices and three petals. The L boundary of the petals is given by the pullback along underline L, and so PV has L boundary at the true vertex. It is easy to see that the false petal has L boundary at the false vertex, and the true petal has L boundary at the true vertex. And so omega is the following bouquet. The conditions on a sub-bouquet R of X, classified by figures in omega, occurs at two levels. For V figures, if little x is a V element of X, either X is in R or X is not. For L figures, if alpha is a petal of X, then either alpha is a petal of R, or alpha is not a petal of R, but its L boundary is a vertex of R, or alpha is not a petal of R, and neither is the L boundary of vertex of R. So for example, if X is a bouquet with vertices A and B and petals alpha, beta, and gamma, and R is a subbouquet with vertex B and petal beta, then on V figures, the characteristic morphism takes vertices A and B to the false vertex and true vertex, respectively, and on petals, alpha, beta, and gamma are taken to the false petal, the true petal, and PV, respectively. Since gamma is not a petal of R, but its L boundary is a vertex of R. In the category of graphs, which is the category of Presheaves on a two-object category with two non-identity morphisms S and T, the Yoneda embedding gives us two morphisms underline S and underline T from the representable on V with one vertex and no arcs to the representable on A with two vertices and one arc between them. The underline S morphism picks out the source of A1, and underline T picks out the target. The subcontainers of underline V are the empty graph and the identity subgraph. The subgraphs of underline A consists of the empty graph, the two graphs which pick out the source vertex and target vertex of underline A, respectively, the subgraph with both vertices and no arc, and the identity morphism. Notice that the order of sub underline A is not linear, since A sub S and A sub T are incomparable. So the subobject classifying graph has two vertices, false and true, and five arcs. By constructing the appropriate pullbacks, we can determine the source and the target boundaries of each arc. For example, A sub V has source and target at the true vertex. A sub S has source at the true vertex and target at the false vertex, and A sub T vice versa. And the true arc and the false arc are loops at the true vertex and the false vertex respectively. The conditions on a subgraph R of X classified by figures in omega comes in two levels. For V figures, with little x as a V element of X, either X is a V element of R or it is not. For A figures, with alpha as an A element of X, then either alpha is an A element of R or alpha is not an A element of R, but the source and target of alpha are V elements of R, or alpha is not in R and the target vertex is not in R, but the source vertex is a vertex of R, or alpha is not an arc in R and the source vertex of alpha is not a vertex of R, but the target vertex is a V element of R, or alpha is not an arc in R and neither the source nor the target vertices of alpha are vertices in R either. So, for example, if X is the following graph with vertices A, B, and C, and arcs alpha, beta, gamma, delta, omega, and R is the subgraph with vertices A and B, and arc alpha, the characteristic morphism for R sends V figures A, B, and C to true, true, false, and sends A figures alpha to true, since it is in R, beta to A sub V, since beta is not an A element of R, but the source and target vertices of beta are V elements of R, gamma to A sub S, since gamma is not an A element of R, and the target vertex isn't a vertex of R, but the source of gamma is in R. Similarly, delta is sent to A sub T, and omega to false. Finally, in the case of reflexive graphs, everything we just showed for graphs translates directly to reflexive graphs, provided we add distinguished loops at each vertex and modify the Yoneda embedding to include underline I, underline sigma, and underline tau. Then the characteristic morphisms must also take the distinguished loops A dot I, B dot I, C dot I to true, true, false. Notice that distinguished loops must always be mapped to either true or false, since morphisms in reflexive graphs must preserve distinguished loops. We should really not think of distinguished loops as arcs at all, but rather as vertex proxies. so that morphisms of graphs are allowed to map arcs to vertices. Another way to view it is that vertices in reflexive graphs are redundant to the structure of a reflexive graph, just as in category theory, objects are redundant since there are identity morphisms.